Good afternoon. I'd like to start today by apologizing for the temperature in here. I've been running the AC continuously since about 2, and it took it from like 79 degrees all the way down to 76 degrees. So I guess that's what we're working with today. So my name is Jamie Hinson Rieger. I am the Director of Worship here at the Unitarian Universalist Church of Indianapolis. And on behalf of our congregation, it is my honor and my privilege to welcome you this afternoon to this healing discussion sponsored by Indy10 and the Kepra Institute. Now, Unitarian Universalism, if you're not familiar, is what we call a non-creedal religion, meaning that we don't have a creed that we say every Sunday. There's no specific set of beliefs you have to be here about God or Jesus or heaven or hell or what have you. We respect that each person is on their own individual path to truth, and we respect their freedom of thought and conscience. So we tend to be a very diverse group here, people coming from Christian background, Jewish, atheist, agnostic, Muslim, pagan, and just free thinker miscellaneous. What holds us together is a covenant to live out certain core values, which we embody in 7 principles. And one of those principles is we say we work for the inherent worth and dignity of each person. We say that each person is beautiful, that each person matters. And another of those principles is we say we work for justice and equity in human relationships. And a third principle is that we say we're working for a peaceful world for ourselves and our children and our children's children. So last year at our big annual meeting that we have every year, we passed a very important resolution. And this resolution said, recognizing that white supremacy is the cultural water that we're all swimming in, that if we really want to say we're working for the inherent worth and dignity of each person, we have to be prepared to say loud and clear that black lives matter. And recognizing that because the history of America is the history of the systematic theft and violence directed against black people, and because that theft and violence is still embodied in the institutions that frame American life, if we want to say that we're fighting for justice and equity, we have to say loud and clear that black lives matter. And finally, because in the words of our former president, Bill Sinkford, in America, violence against black bodies is our national heritage. And because we see this violence played out over and over again in Tamir Rice and Rekia Boyd, and Michael Crawford and Mike Brown, if we want to say that we're working for a world of peace, we have to be prepared to say loud and clear that black lives matter. So last year we passed a resolution calling on all of our congregations to affirm and promote the Black Lives Matter movement. And this year at our big national convention, this year that I actually just got back in from midnight last night, we raised in a single day $90,000. It's three times the size of any donation we've ever raised. $90,000 that we gave to an organizing collective called Black Lives of UU, signaling our commitment that we are empowering black leaders to do this work in our congregation. So all of this is to say that when Indy10 approached me about a month ago asking if they could use our space to have a healing community discussion on police violence, and that the Kepra Institute was going to be co-sponsoring this event, that was the easiest yes that I have ever been happy to say. So on behalf of my congregation, I'd like to say to Indy10 and the Kepra Institute, thank you for the work that you are doing, thank you for your leadership, and thank you for bringing this vital conversation to our community. And now I believe I have said enough. So I am going to turn the microphone over to Indy10, Kyra, Leah, and Ethan. Thank you.
Hi. Thank you all for coming out here. I'm Leah. I'm with Indy10. Indy10 began 2 years ago almost. We went down to Ferguson, Missouri a week after Michael Brown was murdered. And we just are a group of random people from Indianapolis who got together and figured that we needed to do something here in our city to change it. Because we know that this is an isolated incident. We know that things like Michael Brown and Tamir Rice don't just happen in other cities. We know they happen right here at home. So we decided to come back here and try and make a difference. And we like to hold discussions like this. Hopefully we'd like to host some more in the future.
Thank you all for coming, and I hope we have a really valuable and important discussion on things that need to be discussed more often, including, you know, healing, which is the title of this discussion panel, and dive into what it means and who needs to do it and what needs to change in order for all people to feel more secure in their own bodies and their own homes and their own communities.
After this is over, we will also have a balloon release, and we will have you guys just write down messages or names of victims of police violence, and then we will release it afterwards. Thank you. And now we're going to call up Theon Lee. He is a local artist and poet here in the Indianapolis community, and he's going to recite some wonderful spoken word for you guys.
Hello, hello. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Cool. All right. My name is Theon Lee. I'm a performance artist here in Indianapolis. I'm going to execute two of those performance arts. One is spoken word, the other one is hip hop, also known as emceeing, also known as rapping. So, these are the two pieces. The first piece I have for you is called City Garden. Roses are red and violets are blue. Roses are red and violets are blue. That's until those red roses provoke poses that make those violets have to get violent. See, no pardon from gardeners from other parts, just purple hearts and targets. Thrown darts and cold sparks is what made my concrete gardens get hardened. Transmit your pigment if you want and see how far you get. It will be the palette of the petal that jumpstarts the battle of the metal. As a matter of fact, where you're standing right now, whether you were flat or you were settled, where you were born is where you are buried, and that is your burrow. No getting broken into being thorough. Don't deny the disciple truths connected to your roots. To let good is to let go. Your flower bed is a dumpster instead. This ain't the garden, this is the ghetto. But if it ain't a reference to God, then it's the devil. But on the inside, there probably is no God, just a Geppetto, iPod and television channel. Our digital synthesis desensitize our photosynthesis to the extent where no one mentions it. Leave it to weed and seed to show you what constriction is, where the weeds die of diseases, so their seeds can't perceive what victor is and wisdom is. Replaced with them puny ass trees that ain't even indigenous, even in the scrimmages when niggas is killing over pigment. Niggas is ignorant, just like my nigga said, red petal, blue petal, flower the same thing, so why do pupils of discrepancy have the necessity to gangbang? How can Mother Nature maintain where every other range gets gang slang and the rain sings a song that sounds a lot like bang bang? Yes, roses are red and violets are blue, but pigs are pink and they got their clicks too. So no barging for the badge, wearing trick, who gets paid, commits to rip through my resident shoes, who wanna earn my respect, learn how to serve and protect. Run, tell that to the people who convince you that you ain't doing the same thing these Sewells and Crips do. And Crown Vicks with high sirens, with bright lights that blind that it is roses red and violets blue, suffocating brothers by the end, cutthroat over colors. Cloths and cloaks serving as covers, masking surreal stimulus, a fact that when those roses and violets grow silent, the only colors in the boxes is black. Roses are red, violets are blue, only for another cancerous collision to occur again, because two flowers don't see that they're a part of the same stem. So every rose has its thorn. Every violet has its violet past, and this garden will never get any taller than its own grass. Roses are red, violets are blue, and if I was that colorblind, I'd be trying to kill you too. Thank you. So for this next piece, I would just like to put out there a little warning. Language warms up a little bit, but only with the intent of capturing the essence of where the emotion is coming from the piece, from the experience. This piece is untitled. I guess I'll go ahead and snap. If you feel like snapping with me, feel free to. Red lights flashed, and all I seen was a couple of them. Man, it was beautiful. Wouldn't think they was up to nothing. Red, red, black on the corner. Somebody cousin or husband, but tell them not to say nothing. That'll be dumping. Blue lights flashing, all I seen was a couple of them. Man, it was beautiful, wouldn't think they was up to nothing. Red, red, black on the corner, somebody cousin, a husband. Tell them not to say nothing, that'll be dumping. You ask how I'm feeling? Don't trust nothing with a badge. Is that past my fulfillment? Or my submission to taxes, the rashes of killings? Disproportionate of the average civilian, they overcasting more than half of my village. I used to feel like it was gonna pass all my passions and feelings until I felt that flash creep across my bag with a tag in it. Bad itches and tragic, black trended with caps. Let him pass, stick to his ass, live it, then give it gas and my glass. Like, nigga, where you headed? Oh, you got something to say? Open your door and repeat it, cause I can tell you said it. Ends up reaching for his weapon. It's getting stressful, and now my only question is, who protects me from the protection? What was I supposed to do? Let him kill me and pray? Was I been wearing a suit and voted different that day? Was I system a bit too janky? Was I listening to Dre? Was I too African and too primitive for living that way? And to say, it's just a racism. It's all my fault. My walk, my talk. I shouldn't have at all got smart. I should say all lives matter, that we all not marked. I should put both hands out before the car got parked. Too tall, too dark, too timid. What, I was intimidating you, but couldn't keep my cool because you was intimidating too. Eliminate the truth. You trying to eliminate me too. Systemic hate and brute. Judicial discrimination proof is why black people don't trust cops or trust judges. Black people own bus stops, don't love buses. Black people own rust drops and drug junkies. Black people own the low loaf God and love buckets. Black people don't trust cops or trust judges. Black people own bus stops, don't love buses. Black people own rust drops and drunk junkies. And a black man who don't love self, don't love nothing. My name is Theon Lee. Thank you for having me.
June 16, 2016. So I'm here today to bring awareness to the community and So stopping the violence and bringing everyone together. Thank you.
Okay, so maybe the first two questions, what you'll see is I'd love for everyone to kind of answer, right? Because everyone's going to have a response. And after that, we'll just kind of go pop. If you, you know, feel it, go ahead and let it out. So, we kind of know and understand that trauma in the Black community, we get dated back to the Mafia, what we know as African Holocaust, what many know as slavery in the United States. So it's been a couple hundred years, several hundred, but, you know, we've kind of dealt with these attacks and, you know, just this sheer violence from the state. And then now what we're experiencing is a little bit of even more sanctioned violence from the state. So the question I want to ask first for everyone is, what do you consider to be Black healing? What is Black healing to you? Anybody?
I have said at the beginning, and even today, a part of my healing process must include justice. Without justice, I have no closure. Without closure, I cannot even conceive what it is to start to heal.
Healing to me looks like just bringing awareness. I feel like enough people don't know. So to me, like, it heals me. It makes me feel better when I go out there and I educate people, other Black people, about systems that have been brought against us. And I make stories like Debbie or Christopher Goodlow. I bring those to the light. I let people know that these people have been murdered by the state and they're not getting any justice. I like the fact that we're teaching others. That's what how I feel personally.
In some instances for me, healing just revolves around being in an all-Black room with all Black people, really talking about what really affects us. I think sometimes when we bring other people in, and there's nothing wrong with that, but we have to be able to talk to each other in reality about white supremacy and what's really going on. And without those certain special circles, I don't know if we'll really get to the point of healing.
I think healing for me would be just realizing that what happened, the before, the after, you know, process of it all, realizing what happened and what we can do to prevent it.
I will be honest and say I really don't know. I think we try a lot of different things. I think we should keep trying. I think justice is definitely one of them, but justice in this country is, you know, pretty much a joke. So even if a cop is prosecuted and somehow sent to prison, I don't know if that's healing for the overall Black populace of people, because it still reoccurs constantly, right? So it's not something that, it's a hard question to wrestle with. What is healing? Because there's individual healing and then there's also communal healing, right? And how do we heal not only as individuals, but as a community? I think that's the question I just like to pose to everybody, because I honestly don't know. So.
I guess I'd like to start by saying that the world's very unhealed, globally, and getting sicker every day. And the possibilities of life on this planet is under attack by this particular form of existence. So it's a global toxicity that makes it difficult, if not impossible, to stay healed. So through the lens of African experience, as you already referenced, you know, we've been at war under attack from the time we were enslaved and brought here against our will. And the only thing that changes is the nature of the attack. So we resist, and in that resistance, new things occur that quote unquote supposed to protect us, and then that's tricked and changed, and we stay under attack. In the modern era, thanks to the cell phones and our ability to capture the stories of police violence, a particular form of state violence, we've been able to convince others who don't look like us to say, oh, wow, these folks have been telling the truth all along. They kill us. So healing in a toxic environment is really almost impossible to heal. So then you create spaces that allow you to protect yourself and to do some form of healing. The church has historically served in that role. Organizations, particularly some independent institutions, have served in that role to allow people of color to come together and share and tell their stories with each other. You know, there's oftentimes when police kill one of us, we've come together in smaller circles and just talk. It's a form of healing. Our artists, Theon, brother here, create art forms that capture and attempt to restore our sense of self and spirit. So there's a lot of things we do. Resistance, you talk about resistance. Our resistance is a form of healing. So those are the kinds of things that I think that lead to that on a personal level. You know, I don't think you are going to be, how can you be okay if the water's all dirty and polluted and toxic? You're not going to be healthy. None of us are. So we just have to do these things to try to protect ourselves and renew our spirits and maintain our faith. This particular panel discussion, this discussion with other folks who don't look like us, who get it, and say, hey, what can we do? Assist in that process, I think. So, good food, good music also helps.
Thanks, Sam. I think it kind of touched on, everybody. I think that kind of touches on naming things, right? So if we're naming, we talk about state violence, and we name it from this level, from the community level here in Indianapolis. When we talk about people being, you know, shot down in the streets, we're talking about the IMPD. So I think it's safe to say that. And so I guess the real question is, how does the IMPD handle black citizens here?
When I was listening to everybody talk, and certainly with my own experience and talking to different people, I think what has happened a lot is the honesty. IMPD and the trust between IMPD and us as citizens, I think that first we have to be honest and understand that there is a problem. And today in real life, we trust IMPD and the system to support us and to have our backs and to help us, to protect us. And when they turn around and we're put in a situation where we have to question their honesty, then, you know, you have to ask yourself, you know, what is their real purpose? Are they really there to serve and protect us? And I personally, I have lost a lot of trust in the system with IMPD. Not saying that all cops are bad cops. I do not believe that. I'm a former deputy. I worked at the Sheriff's Department for many, many years. So I understand what goes on a little bit inside the department, and also definitely outside of the department, having lost my husband to police violence. But I think that it has to be a point to where we have to stop and say, okay, yes, black lives matters, all lives matters, but we have to, as a people, look at the situation and understand that there is a problem that exists. It exists today. It's not decades ago. It's right now, right here, right now. And it's very much real. And it should not have to take you losing someone close to you or getting a call saying that somebody that you love has been, their life has been taken by IMPD or by any other means. And it's not just police violence, but they treat violence on our people different, period. I have, my best friend lost her sister, and you all have to forgive me because this is really emotional for me. I can't even sit here and pretend to even talk to you and not you not see the emotion in me because it hurts. It's real to me. But my best friend lost her sister. It's been about 2 years ago, Mary. She was getting in her car, getting ready to leave, and basically someone killed her in her backyard. IMPD today has not solved that case. They want to keep pointing fingers saying that it's our people because we won't step up, we won't tell, okay? I'm sitting next to my son. His wife lost her brother a week ago. Someone broke into his house and shot him in his sleep. Haven't seen that on the news, haven't seen the aggression with we're gonna find that killer, we're gonna do this, we're gonna, as we saw in the Amanda Blackburn case. We are different. We are treated different. It should not have to come to our individual back door for us to stand up and say there is a problem with how we as black people are treated when it comes to violence.
Discussion with the new chief of police, Troy Riggs, a few months ago, and this question came up, how will we make sure that nothing like Cleveland happens here, or things like Michael Brown, how do we make sure, how can he guarantee that that wouldn't happen here in Indianapolis? And his response was like, oh, my officers wouldn't do that, like my officers aren't like that. And so then I posed the question, I said, what kind of training are your officers getting that they won't roll out of a car and in 0.2 seconds shoot a 12-year-old. And he was very dismissive. I feel like IMPD is very quick to like dismiss things like this. They feel like Indianapolis or Indiana isn't really, you know, we're not the type of city that's gonna riot or anything. So they're quick to sweep it under the rug. They don't really pay attention to their black citizens or the things that we, the threats that we were posing. We're saying like, we feel threatened by your officers and they're quick to like sweep under the rug or push it to the side. They don't feel threatened by us or their citizens. They look like we're gonna rise up or say anything about the way they treat us. That's how I feel.
As a young black man, it's definitely hard. I mean, I'm 31 years old. I can relate to back when I was 16 years old getting my first driver's license and being pulled over by the police. They do treat us differently. I don't want to use it as an excuse on as our race as a whole, but it does happen. I mean, we've been oppressed for so many years. I can recall getting in my car, you know, driving down the street. I got pulled over twice on the same block. Not because I didn't have my seat belts or had turn signal issues, because I was a black man. It does happen in our neighborhood. I mean, I'm frankly tired of it. I mean, and at the end of the day, we do have to step up and take responsibilities and say, there is a problem. And it's not a white and black issue or anything like that. It's about respect. It's about the people, knowing who we are as individuals, knowing them as individuals. And I think that's what really the problem is. People don't take the time out to figure out who this person is as an individual. They automatically assume, because he's a black man, that he's gonna be violent. That's not the case. Not everybody's like that, you know what I mean? So I would say this. I think it's two things, a lack of knowledge and a lack of respect that IMPD needs to use. They need to work closely with the youth, closely with the neighborhoods, and identifying the troubled people versus the, you know, the productive people. But I think it's definitely an issue in here in Indianapolis, Indiana.
Police are the police. Indiana, Chicago, New York. Police have one primary role. That's protect the interests of the state, which means protect the interests of white supremacy. So for me, it's as simple as that. Yes, I'm 58 years old. Yes, the police have stopped me God knows how many times. And I'm always expected when I see the police to be pulled over and stopped. And I'm always assuming that there are going to be assumptions about what I've done, who I am, based on how I look and often how I dress, and et cetera, et cetera. So without getting into the micros of my own personal stories, that's the role of police. Now we should at some point talk about how to mitigate it, how to reduce it, how to train police officers, et cetera, to do a better job of not killing us randomly and treating us differently than others. But at the end of the day, their role is to protect the interests of the state, bottom line. It ain't about protecting you or your property. It's about states. If you remember a few years ago when some young teenagers were shooting downtown at Black Expo, I think it was. It was full court press about that. Full court press about young black teenagers creating violence downtown. That's about property and money. So that's my take on that.
Yeah, I'm going to have to completely agree with Beam on that. I mean, it's a fraternal order that they follow from Indy, Chicago, whatever. They are trained to treat us like dogs. Not even that. I mean, I don't feel like the black race is seen as human. I mean, and that's exactly what we are humans. We do the same things as everyone else. I mean, drink water, whatever, the same thing. So, and I'm also gonna attribute it to years of stuff we see on TV. I mean, black man, black child, black woman, all seen in derogatory ways, and they're trained this, and they're taught this by their parents, and I mean, like we're seeing now, I don't know whoever's surprised by this, I'm sorry if you are, but racism is so real, it's sickening. I asked my grandmother, who was born in 33, how she feels about racism then and now. And I mean, she just basically said back then we stayed in our own communities, so we didn't have to deal with that. Oh, we don't have a chance now, and I have a lot of cool white people in my life, so, you know, I don't want to segregate myself. But it's really hard to, you know, me and a friend Sarah of mine will go down the street and potentially, if we get pulled over and I'm driving, it could be a whole different scenario. I mean, I've even had a white friend in the car when I've gotten pulled over, and because of her Hungarian last name and because it was a joke to the police, we got off. Because she was just a nice little white girl. And I went to school down in Evansville, Indiana. If you don't know, it's the most southern point of the state. Racism, I would say, is a little more in the forefront, but I can see it. And coming back here, it's been like 2 years, and I would say it's almost not as different. They just try to hide it a little more. But I would say they don't treat us like humans. And it comes from, I would say, fear at its most rawest point, but we're here to kind of figure that out.
Segue into kind of another little short question. This, you know, Indianapolis is a city in the north, but it had a, you know, a segregated school. Like, you know, there was this whole thing behind why that should happen. And this was at a time when that was the story in the South, you know, so we have this myth of how progressive the north can be, which, you know, we all know is iffy. So what role does kind of the culture of Indiana or Indianapolis play into all of this? That's kind of a good question. Like if we were in Kentucky, we could talk about, you know, slavery. I do know Indiana had, you know, even beyond the emancipation, but we could talk about like these historical representations violence that we're speaking of, the state violence and this, you know, the kind of the mob rule, lynching is in front of folks and everything. But I haven't seen a lot of that in the history books with Indiana. If it is, it's not, it hasn't been, you know, brought to the forefront, I guess. I'm not saying I'm an expert on Indiana history, but I am curious about, you know, kind of this culture. Like I was surprised to kind of find out that there hadn't really been an uprising here. That of note, you know what I mean? So compared to, you know, a Chicago or Detroit, you know, or whatever, what does any of this say about the culture of Indiana's history when it comes to black folks. And that's for anybody. It might be the tax
record.
I always move with the premise that Malcolm said. He said, stop talking about the South. Anything south of the Canadian border is the South. So it all is just manifesting in its own forms of white supremacy. I mean, it may manifest differently in Indiana than it does in New York, but it's still white supremacy, it's still capitalism, and I think it's important to keep that in perspective. As far as Indiana specifically, I'm originally from Muncie, Indiana, and I know in my city, black people switched from voting Republican to Democrat, not because of Roosevelt, but because the Klan had so heavily infiltrated the Republican Party. And we have to remember this is a state that the Klan ran from the governor down, right? That's the history here. This is one of the headquarters of the Ku Klux Klan here. Growing up, my little brother had a field trip. They were supposed to go see a civil rights reenactment, and they had to cancel that because there was a Klan rally that day. This is in Newcastle, Indiana. And this is just a few stories where I'm, even though this is the North, like, Confederate flag was sold at the gas station. You can get it as a license plate. For Muncie again, one of the high schools called the Southside Rebels used to fly the flag for years. We actually did have race riots there. There's a neighborhood called Shedtown where it was one of those, as they call them in the South, those get out of town by sundown type mm-hmm. situations. You just didn't go there after a certain time because you might not come home, right? Even driving around the state to this day, any black person will tell you, if you're in between Indianapolis and Bloomington, you don't want to stop at Martinsville, you don't want to stop at any of these places, because you, again, might not make it home, right? So this is the legacy that has always been here. And those are just a few examples. There's many more that I'm sure people could share. So it's always been a cloud hanging over it, but I think Indiana kind of likes to use the fact that it's in the South to seem more progressive than what it is, to seem like there's this Hoosier hospitality for everyone, and that doesn't really apply to everybody across the board. So,
yeah, Hoosier hospitality is a lie. It's just white supremacy. I just feel like, especially the good point you touched on about the, you know, the Klan. The Klan was here. Wasn't it started in what, Greencastle? Mm-hmm. So it's like, I don't know how to really say this, but I just think that they've tried to do a good job at silencing people. I don't know, just scaring people. I don't really know. I can't speak for anything before 91. But I was born and raised in Indianapolis, lived in Southern Indiana for the past 5 years, came back, and it's all the same. It's white supremacy in Indiana. I just feel like, yeah, I'm gonna hold the door for you, but I might call you a nigger behind your back. And I mean, that's just real. Sorry, I hope that doesn't offend anybody, but we're healing, so. Just goes back to white supremacy.
Well, Indiana is a very conservative state, so, and all those things I agree with. I do think, in reference to 60s and riots, et cetera, some of it might have to do with population density, that even though it was big city with a little city,
right?
But I would also like to add that there have always been pockets of resistance. Those stories are just not told. There's a Black Panther Party that was alive and well during that period. And so he who controls the narrative controls the reality. So a lot of times the story about Indiana is told by others who want to paint a particular story about resistant voices. You know, I come out of a community of resistance. I think that would be my comment about that. Other than that, it's the same to all of the same like sister said.
So
on this thing on education, I do want to say something about that. You know, back during the segregated era of racial apartheid in America, one of the benefits of that was a community that was at least in control of its own education. And so the stories that you want to make sure were told.
Yep.
And so one of the disadvantages, one of many, of an integrated school system was one, we sent our children to hostile racial environments
yes.
that created all kinds of crises. mental challenge with our own children and as children. So that was one of the fundamental, to lose control of your own education is to lose control of your mind. And so I think that's a critical piece of what took place to our career.
So living in Indianapolis, I have to concur off of what you said and also what you said. I was born in the South, believe it or not. And I've been in the city in Indianapolis for a very long time. But Indianapolis to me, when I think about Indianapolis and all the years that I've spent here and everything that I have been going through, to me, if you ask me, I think Indianapolis is far worse than the South. And the reason I say that is because in the South, make no mistake about it, if a person wants to call you a nigger, they're gonna call you a nigger in your face in the South. Here in Indianapolis, it's hidden behind smiles. You know, you still that same nigger, but they don't want to say it to you in your face, so they smile at you. And like I said, when you turn your back, then you hear the word. And I don't mean any disrespect by the word. And if you know, if you're the type of person that you know what you're dealing with, you know how to multitask between that and how to go on about your life. And that's easily done. But when you don't know you're faced with that type of treatment and it's hidden from you, you find yourself in situations where it hits you in your face all the time. I look at it in the situation of Indianapolis versus the South is, if I see a snake and I know I don't like snakes, I see that snake over there, I'm going the other direction. But here in Indianapolis, those snakes are slithering, they're all around us and you can't see them. So how can you, I'd rather fight you knowing that you're there versus trying to know how, what my defense is gonna be if I don't know that you're there. So I know that it's kind of like talking around in circles, but we can deal with what's honestly and openly presented to us versus what's hidden. The Klan, yes, in all avenues and different entities here in this city. Oh my goodness, to live here and have some of the things happen to you behind the scenes and people, like I said, it's the big white elephant in the middle of the room nobody wants to discuss. But it is so important that we recognize that it is very much in Indianapolis. And it has been in Indianapolis. People in the South, I feel like they have moved on. When I go to the South, I am treated much better because I know if the people don't like me, they're not gonna deal with me in the South. But here, they'll deal with me and make me think that they have my best interest at heart, but the whole time, they don't like me. So, I mean, how do you balance that? How do you fight against that? How do you stand against that? You know, that goes back to that honesty I was talking about earlier. Gotta have it.
We were speaking about honesty. We're speaking about, you know, the white elephant in the room, as it were. We have a journalist on the dais with us. We have someone who organizes with the use of technology. And we've kind of touched on this a little bit, but I do want to pose the question, what role does the media play?
No.
Yeah. So let's get into that.
Okay, I'm gonna start off. I got my bachelor's in journalism. So I was trained with, like, I think there was one other black girl in our whole major, but she didn't participate in the paper, so they didn't see her as, I don't know, valuable or whatever. I did though. But so I was pretty involved. And they really teach you, oh, it's just a bunch of BS, honestly. Like, the media plays all of the role. I just started reading The New Jim Crow, and Michelle Alexander talks about how in the 80s, the images that were being portrayed of crack, and specifically black men, women, and children. And you see that in your homes, and let's say, you know, you're a person who lives in, I don't know, rural wherever, where you see only the same people as you. If you see that and it's someone who looks different than you, you're gonna be frightened. The media is telling you, oh, be scared, be aware, lock your doors, blah, blah, blah. I mean, they're really, I would say, extremely instrumental in feeding the lies, scaring people, terror, terror. I mean, I hate broadcast journalism and a lot of newspapers for that reason. That's why I work for myself, because once you, and I can't even say it's all the writers. I have to say it goes ahead. I mean, editorial staff, the owner of the paper, because they're trying to keep the best interest of their audience, which they don't care about us. you know, a lot of elite whites, I would say, are certain audiences. I mean, I would say NPR, like, that's kind of my saving grace. But I don't know. The media is a joke in a lot of instances, as someone who is a journalist.
I just want to give a quick example. Media. In my personal situation, for example, when my husband was first shot by APD, the very first stories that came out when I went home and sat down and turned on the TV, oh my goodness. The first stories that were reported, I mean, the media ran his name through the mud. Oh, he had drugs on him. He had multiple clips. He had shot at police. Oh, there were so many stories about what my husband supposedly did that day. Only to turn around and find out, when it boiled down to it, that none of that was the truth. To me, I felt the media had a responsibility and an obligation to clear my husband's name. You know, they were so eager to put the information out there to the public. So when I went to try to get assistance with trying to find out what happened to my husband, all my own people shut me down. Because they listened to the press, they listened to the stories, and nobody took time to get the facts. The press is not, most times they know that what they're presenting to the public is not the facts, but they don't care about that. They don't care about us. They're not reporting the news to be beneficial to us. They're just trying to gain exposure. So for me, the press, I feel like I wish they would just shut them all down. Shut them down. Because if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. And it keeps a lot of people from getting justice. And the last thing a person wants to do after losing their loved one is have somebody go on public national television and start telling a bunch of horrific stories about that person. You don't even know them. You don't know them. No, they don't. And it's a hurtful situation, but it's also, I feel like we're victimized by them as well. The press. Bottom line, I just say that we're victims of the press as well. They help others to do their job, you know, that is on the negative side of what we really need right here, right now. So.
Well, the press is just an extension of the same thing. Yep. Corporate owned, corporate control, yep. Homies yep. In the room together.
Yep.
When the shooting takes place, PR for the police department, contact whoever it is, back and forth, they tell the story, they print the story, business as usual. So, we really just should get our business from those traditional sources. We should do like these young people here, the sister here, who's got her own thing going. Wise Lodge's got a pod. What's the name of the show, Wise?
The Historical Perspective and Analysis Show.
Historical Perspective starts on an independent podcast show. Chaos got media in the room. We do social media. One of the advantages we have now with the technology is we can tell our own stories.
Yeah.
And get the word out. Well, here's what really happened.
Right.
And, you know, that's about us getting out and getting busy and doing the work necessary to say, no, that's some nonsense and some garbage. So I would just challenge all of us to be looking at that particular. Even with this thing with the video control that the police have managed to say, okay, well, we don't control the video. We're not going to release the video. Well, you know, we can do that ourselves. You know, police show up in the community, call your neighbor, say, look, police there, get your cameras out. So, I mean, there's some things that we are capable of doing that we should begin to do because we know that they're not going to do it for us. We know that when they do it, they're going to do it in the context of protecting the interests of the state.
Absolutely.
So even later, after they come back and retract it, well, the damage is done. You know, story's been told, it's done. Nobody does it anymore. And then that old story, the trap, well, he had drugs on him, he had guns on him. You know, he told a lie, the lie has now become the truth. So we do have the capacity to redirect the narrative, to tell our own story. So that's what we should do.
I just wanted to
tell a really quick story about our experience with the media. We had a protest last year for the Indy 500, and I was at work. I worked 12-hour shifts, and quickly my phone just started blowing up. And I'm like, what's happening? And I looked on Facebook, and then the Channel 6 News said that we were planning to like hold a violent protest at the, what was the word they used? It wasn't protest, it was something else. At the Indy 500, they said we were gonna go and like disrupt the parade. And like, it was like a warning. They said national security had to try to be in contact with us. None of us had ever talked to the national security ever. They said they were in contact with us, trying to stop us from, they were worried. Like, and the media just blew it out of proportion. It was just a simple protest at the parade. They turned it into like a threat. It was really scary, and I work with people who are from like Greenwood and Greenfield, so they believe in everything that the media says. They thought that like, they see a black person like gets killed on the east side, and they're asking me like, Liz, you know them, or like, how do you feel about this? I'm like, you guys, like, I don't know every person. Like, the media is nothing but a bunch of fear mongers, and for someone who comes from Greenwood, like, Indianapolis is a scary place for them. And like, I feel like the media just perpetuates the fear of black folks.
I definitely think the media is propaganda. I remember as a child watching TV, and I remember just yesterday turning on the television and witnessing what I was seeing. The television network, for some reason, it's just sex sales, violence sales. That is what they're putting their money into. That's where they want the media to go to. And it's sickening because the kids, they look up and they watch TV and they see all these things. They see the death, the violence, the gore on TV, which, and they're familiarizing these children with this stuff. So that's why you see a spike in violence, where kids think it's good to shoot guns and fight each other because this is what they see on their everyday recurrence on TV. Versus when I was young, you know, it was a lot of news channels and cartoons and stuff like that. You didn't really see half-naked women, violence, sexual explicit material. You didn't see those type of things on television back in the day. Now it's getting worse and worse, and the kids are watching it. And they, of course, their minds like sponges. They soak up everything they see. My son is 4 years old, and he recites everything he watches on TV. So with that being said, limited time your kids watching television is definitely something positive. Watch, make sure you're aware of what they're watching, when they're watching it. And then don't allow them to watch it after a certain night on television, because that's when all the bad stuff goes on, and they're going to sit and watch it if you let them.
There's a term by a writer at this website called Radiant Layer. It's called post-mortem media violence. Basically to say that this death is not the final act. So once someone is killed by the police, black person specifically, their character is assassinated through different means after they die or after their murder. So like the sister was saying, all of these negative stories are put out about the victim. And somehow you would think that the victim killed the police officer, you know, based on how the narrative is actually told, right? And it's all to justify that this particular individual deserved it, because in order to maintain white supremacy, you have to maintain the inhumanity of black people. To allow black people to be seen as human beings would actually start to dismantle the entire idea of it, because that's what it's based on. Even when we look at the popular cases around this country, like Trayvon Martin, we call it the Trayvon Martin trial. Trayvon Martin wasn't on trial. Trayvon Martin was dead. He couldn't speak for it. That was the George Zimmerman trial, right? When we think about some of the shootings that happened, or when Jordan Davis, it was a kid who he was playing loud music in his car, and a white man found a problem with that, so he shoots into the car because they're playing loud music. They roll away and he shoots it again. And that's the only way they were able to actually convict him, was on the second shot. The first one, they just called it self-defense. But they called that the loud music trial. They didn't call that, I don't even remember the man's name, but that's the whole point. I'm not supposed to remember his name, but I remember Jordan Davis's name. I don't remember the person that actually killed these brothers and these sisters. I remember the people who are dead. And that's the form of post-mortem media violence, is to continually attack you and almost re-traumatize us after the person has passed away, and constant. That's what, when we're talking about healing, how can you heal when you're constantly being traumatized by this? Even when the video floats down the timeline, like, I mean, it was one time I was trying to write a poem, and I might actually do it at the end of this. I was trying to write a happy poem. I just pulled out my phone and checked to see what's going on. I rolled out, and it's some scrolling. And then it was when Walter Scott got shot. This was in South Carolina. He was running away, and the cop shoots him in his back. I couldn't write a happy poem after that, you know? Like, but that's the type of traumatization that happens. Even if I don't know this brother, I'm still hurt by this. It still affects me, and this happens with all Black people. It still affects us. We're constantly being harmed, and that's violence. That causes trauma, that causes stress. That's just as much violence as somebody actually putting their hands on me. So the media is a weapon. You have to see it as that. It's not simply just pushing a narrative. It's actually a weapon. It is actually harming and causing issues within the Black community just as much as the police. It can be just as violent as the police without ever actually shooting a gun.
I just wanted to add one more thing. You guys are all hitting like A1 points. Do not let your kids, don't watch the news. Don't watch it. If it bleeds, it leads. That's what we were taught in journalism. That was like the first thing I can remember. If it bleeds, it leads. Trayvon Martin. He was on trial. I mean, I remember one thing like, oh yeah, he was suspended in school for one day. Why do I know that? Why do we know that? Why is that important? That is nothing.
He was smoking weed.
Why? Yeah. Why?
But the Gorilla case, they listed the father's criminal record. Harambe, what was his name? For no reason, like it doesn't matter, the father wasn't even there, they put his criminal record out there. Also, was it CNN? When Trayvon Martin was killed, they also showed his dead body on TV the first week it happened. They don't care. They don't care about us. And a lot of the times the writers are not Black or are not open to these type of theories or experiences. And then even if they are, the editors are taking, I mean, I've had my story cut up, written up, rewrite it. Or I'm gonna take it from you and I'm gonna publish it myself. And so sometimes you're not even, if I put my heart into this and it's truth, it's gonna get cut down by the editor, cut down by the copywriter, cut down by someone else, and then print. Because if it bleeds, it leads. And that's all they care about.
Just to piggyback off of that just real quick, I remember all the times that I talked to the press, none of the points that I talked to the press about concerning my husband ever made the news. They took, I don't care if it was a 4 words that was insignificant to air, that's what they did. Just to keep the focal point that I was trying to make about the death of my husband from getting air on the news. So that's another thing we do. We have to protect ourselves. We have to know, first of all, that the press is not on our team. They're not our friend. So you have to be careful about, and this is a learning experience. I know it was definitely for me, because I never thought, you know, the media, oh, you know, they want to tell my story. Immediately, psychologically, I'm thinking, okay, they want to hear what I have to say. No, that was not it. And so I was led to making all of these long stories made short by them, and they took those the information that I gave them, and they portrayed a story that I hadn't even told them. It's kind of like you can take the story of Little Red Riding Hood, and you can tell a part of Little Red Riding Hood's story, but don't tell the entire story. So by the end of the book, you've told two different stories. All this stuff in the middle is gone. All you heard was the beginning and the end. So when we talk to the press, my thing is keep it short and sweet. Whatever it is you want to say, say it in a couple of words and just keep repeating the same thing. You know what I mean? They killed my husband. I thought 1,000 times I should have just stood there and said, they killed my husband. They murdered my husband. You know, just keep saying the same thing. Don't give them stuff that they can edit, you know, turn it around. And even with the video, they did that same thing with the video. Of course, I would say IMPD did the most of the damage, because my husband was the first one shot in Indianapolis, and there was body cam footage, which is part of having to fight the laws of Indiana, that's another story, and trying to get that video released. But when it was released, first it was redacted by IMPD. They redacted that video and held it for so long so that it would portray the story that they were telling to people about what happened. So when they actually even showed it to the press, they put it on a monitor and the press videoed it from the monitor. And then they took it and they redacted it. So you got the footage going through two separate entities and they're all telling different stories, but the bottom line is the same. That my husband did not need vindicated, that he was in error for some reason. He deserved what happened to him. So it's real important, like I said, I guess when we think about the media, we have to know they're not on our team. They're not there to help us.
Yeah. I would like to add to that. Just here before I came here, I was at Holy Spirit Festival with the Hispanic community, trying to bring awareness to the community. I'm sorry, can you hear me? Just before I got here, I was at the Holy Spirit Festival with the Hispanic community. And what we were doing, we're trying to bring awareness to the Hispanic community. Because if you're aware, 2.3 million people are incarcerated. 1 million of those people are African American. African American are 6% more likely to be incarcerated than any other race. And that needs to stop. But I said that to say this. I went to do an interview with him. And I specifically remember him telling me, take my glasses off because we don't want you looking like a criminal. That was the first thing he said to me before I got in there. I fumbled through my words because I was so in shock about what he said to me. I couldn't even think. I couldn't even focus on what I was supposed to say because I was just so baffled by what he said to me. Take my glasses off so you don't look like a criminal. This is Russell McQuaid.
How do we use, what resources and strategies that confront power, can be used in a way that helps with healing? Does that make sense for everyone?
I would say, from my take on it, informing the people. It's a shame that people can't trust writers. That's what we're taught to do, is tell the truth. That's it, just the facts. That's it. I'm supposed to just quote everything you say and just tell the story. So I think it's important to maintain community newspapers, I'll say the Indianapolis Recorder, something that people can depend on to know, I trust you, this is coming from my community, and I know this is real. And then that itself, it is proof that can be pushed forward to higher, like Congress and things like that. I feel like the police can see that, like we are telling our own story. So I guess, in short, tell your own story so no one else can tell it for you.
What would happen if, as a culture, if we had our own radio station, network, for our people? What would happen? We need to have one. Now, if we took all of our resources and put them together, and we had our own broadcasting station so that we could air our own news as to what actually happens in the black community, I say start there. Not to exclude any other race or heritage, but to start there and make it a focal point of talking about what happens in our community so we're able to counteract the news that they're portraying to the world. That would be an amazing thing. And we have the technology, we have the knowledge, we have the ability to do it, but will we and could we? Oh, I think that would lead to a lot of healing. A lot of healing for us, telling our own story.
I think division is the number one thing. When you got your Carmel neighborhood versus your Martin there in Brightwood, I think we need to, mix the two up. I lived in Brightwood and they bussed me out to Southport to go to school. Had that not happened, I probably would have none of the knowledge I have now versus going to an IPS school. See what I'm saying? I think the division is what's causing the problem. They're dividing us, putting us on separate sides of towns, not because that's where we want to live, because we're not able to afford it. So I think bringing us together as a whole, learning the person that next to you, learning who they are as an individual, what makes them cry, what makes them happy, what makes them sad. I think that would be the best healing process, you know, us coming together as one. Because Black lives matter, true enough, yes it does. But all lives matter, you know what I mean? All lives matter.
Resistance is a form of healing. So when you resist, you know, it feels good. You ain't bound down, nobody telling you what to do, what door to come in, you're scared to talk, scared to answer yourself, no, I'm not doing that. That's a feel-good feeling. Even if they fire you, it's a feel-good feeling. So we have to resist individually and collectively. When we resist individually, others see that. And then hopefully they get courage. So every day we should be resisting where we are. When we see something foul, we should speak up about it. In our workplaces, in our play places, we got a responsibility to say that's foul. Hold on, check that. So, and that feels good. It's a form of healing. So that, and anybody can do that. You don't need any money to do that. Not one dime. But you do need some strength and courage. And when you give up your courage, you give up your freedom. And you don't feel good. You want a room and somebody say, no, we're not doing that. You're going to support this foul stuff and keep your mouth shut. And you do. How you gonna feel good about it when you get home? You can't. So resistance is a fundamental part of healing, and then working together to help build that component. Now on the issue of the technology, we got all the technology. We don't need any money. Well, we're done podcasting. Where are your tools? Are they on the kitchen table?
In my room.
In this room. So we can support those kind of initiatives without. I mean, of course you need money, but we can support these kind of initiatives with no dollars. African people have been doing this without money for a long time. Now, you know, we have one room schools with no resources. People learn how to read and write. We learned how to read and write when it was illegal. They kill you, cut your hands off, and learn how to read and write. We did, there wasn't no money involved, with no air conditioning. No computers. It was all about our desire ever to be free. And the last thing I want to tell you about sustainability. All this stuff about is it sustainable? Is it sustainable? We have a sustainable model. It's our spirit that is sustainable.
Directly, like the system saying, it shouldn't have to come to your front door. We need to be able to see that we collect and we share this problem. And I think art is a good way to do that. And art also is a way that cuts beyond something like the news that often can be boring for young people. It's that way it cuts through something like school or anything. Things that typically are seen as boring, it's a way to express it in ways that are creative, in ways that are interesting, ways that are engaging, expressive, and allows you to find your voice. So yeah, I would say the art.
I would say what Em said, resistance. I feel like that's my preference. Nothing like a good protest. I love a good uprising. So when I was down in Ferguson, like all those officers coming towards us, beating on their batons with their shield and like coming at us with the tear gas, it was traumatizing, it was scary, but at the same time it was liberating. It was like one of the best feels in the world to know that I was down there with hundreds of other people. This one girl who was born in Indiana to a single mother, just like I had no education, just out here fighting for something I truly believed in with hundreds of other people from hundreds of different backgrounds, and we're fighting against the power structure. Whether that one, this is someone asking me, like, did your one body matter down there? I'm like, you know what, it did matter down there. Because like now the powers that be are watching, they see that there are hundreds of just individual random people down there fighting for what they believe in. So a good resistance, like what's going on in Mexico right now makes me so happy. They have two officers that they're holding hostage, and it just makes me so happy that they're fighting for what they believe in and they're not giving up. A good resistance.
I have to agree with her. I'm going on about like 2 months, I lost my job because I was still working with INPD, and I know when we just had, Indiana just had this big hearing at the State House about the laws with body cams and everything, and I kept going to the State House and I kept testifying and I kept getting up there and telling my story, and I'm boohooing, eyes all puffy, crying and everything. It felt good. It felt good because I was standing up for something that I believed in, and I graduated from, yeah, it happened to my husband is gone, I can't bring it back, but if I can make life just a little bit better for the next brother, you know, our next sister. I mean, it meant the world to me. I got to the point where I just didn't care how people looked at me, you know, or what they thought, but just the fact that I was there and I was talking about something that was important and I was fighting for something that was gonna be beneficial for the people that are still here. It was really important, and that was very liberating, and therefore I felt powerful. But just here recently, even they fired me from my job because the police, I had to work with INPD, I worked for loss prevention, and every day I would have to call INPD to process, you know, someone that I had stopped for shoplifting. And long story made short, but they transferred the police officer out to where I was working in my area, so that was his district now. And they came to my job and kind of made a mockery of me at my job and everything. And I knew it was a matter of time before they terminated me because I just, every opportunity that I got to stand up and to speak out, I was doing that. And one police officer himself, he came to me and he told me, he said, Ms. Long, he's like, I'm gonna tell you. He's like, they feel like you just need to shut up and sit down. What happened to your husband happened, he got what he got, and that, and it is what it is, and you just need to go somewhere and shut up and sit down. That was empowering to me, you know? Because in order for you to take the time and even have a thought that I need to shut up and sit down, told me that I was making an impact on something that you were doing. That's power, making an impact. Like Leah said, whether it be 1, 2, 3, or 4, you know, yeah, there is power in numbers, but it has to start somewhere. And I feel like as a community, we need to take it to the street. We need to start walking the streets. I'm talking walking the streets. I don't care if it's 2, 3, 4 of us, and I made it up in my mind, and I've talked to Indy 10 about it, and the only reason I haven't started doing it right now is because my health has not been what it needs to be. But if God gives me the strength, I promise you all, you're going to hear about, oh, Miss Long, that crazy lady, she walking up and down the street, you don't know where she's going. I don't have a destination, but know that I'm walking for a reason. Because, you know, whether or not it's today, tomorrow, or next week, or whatever, we have to keep pressing forward. And that power, that comes from reaching out and going forth, taking one step at a time. No, Rome wasn't built in a day.
That's right.
You may not might have a drastic impact today, but if you take today and turn it into tomorrow and the day after that and that, eventually a change is coming. And that's the only thing that keeps me strong and empowers me right now, just knowing that the bottom's gonna fall out sooner or later.
I agree. I wanted to speak on power specifically. I think power is the ability to legitimize actions, right? You have the institutional control to do so. I think Stokely Carmichael said something to the effect of, if a white man wants to lynch me, that's not my problem. If the white man has the power to lynch me, then that becomes my problem.
Yes.
He has the power to actually legitimize his actions, to do that and to get away with it, and has a whole system behind him to do so. So we think about power in this country, we need to look at it through that. How do we actually legitimize our actions? Power is the ability to say that weed dealers go to jail longer than Wall Street bankers, right? Power is the ability to say that people who kill folks in car crashes are somehow, usually typically tend to be white males, are somehow seen as more benevolent than folks who sell drugs. Like, it's the power to legitimize these actions and to control the narrative and control the propaganda of what is spread. And if that's where the courage again has to come up, and we have to stand up, is to challenge the narrative, is to have a counter narrative, is to have podcasts, is to support institutions that already exist, who have radio shows, who have magazines, who do art. Because we're speaking about resources, often we don't have the resources to get our messages out there like those who are pushing the messages of the status quo, like those who legitimize ideas where it's okay for Wall Street bankers to tank the entire economy and still go do business as usual. Like, that's something that institutionally they can get away with because they have all the support, they have the lawyers, they have the money, everything. So we have to think about how can we fund our institutions and how can we support our institutions even if we don't have the funds necessarily. So we can't spread those narratives, so we can't change the narrative, have a counter narrative. Because again, this is a war. I know people don't like to admit to that, but if somebody has a gun pointed at you, you have to figure out a way to deal with that. You can't just act like the gun's not there. It's aimed straight at your face. So how do we deal with that?
So we're gonna further the dialogue. Before we do, I want to get final thoughts from each one of the participants. Could we give some appreciation for them? And also, I've been informed that there's cold water, hot tea, soda, and snacks in the social hall, which I believe is directly. Right, okay, directly out there, help yourselves.
Focusing on violence, period, like in the educational system, with environmental racism, all these things, Black Lives Matter has expanded. So just stay with us, talk to your peers, spaces that I can't get into, hopefully you can get into, and you'll speak for us, or direct them in our way. Just don't give up on the movement. We're in this for a long haul, and so hopefully you will be too.
Well, first of all, thank you to the audience, thank you to the panelists, thank you to the church for bringing us together to have this conversation. I'm really appreciative of Andy Tien's struggle and journey to maintain their involvement in the work. I want to
testimony to your efforts to take the long road. It's renewing for old men to see young people in the game. So thank you. And encourage, as Sister Hilda said, you know, to have these conversations outside the space with others. And you just don't know how those kinds of conversations touch others, then touch others to touch others. And that's really another way to bring about change.
Again, thank you. This is my first panel discussion, and this is something I'm clearly very passionate about. So I appreciate you all being here. I mean, everybody of all different races. I know in the beginning I said, you know, strictly black spaces are essential for healing, but I also think white allies, or allies in general, I won't just say white, are essential. You know, we got Students Against State Violence. You know, you guys are awesome. And just, like, definitely continue the conversation. Don't stop. If you see something wrong, say something across the board. I mean, it does make you feel good to say, hey, no, we're not going for it. Finally, tell your own story. Don't let somebody try to change you, tell you, no, this is how it should be. No, I experienced this. I live a black life, so I know the truth. Tell the truth, and don't go along with the media. Tell your own story. I feel like that I could say that 30 times. Tell your story.
Thank you all for taking the time out to come and to join with us in the panel discussion. I thank ND10 for inviting me to sit on the panel. I consider it an honor to be able to just share with you all. Thank you for the uses, the owners of the building, for even allowing us to be here. And my thoughts is just the awareness. If something that was said here today was informative enough to some one of you, that you can go and say, hey, I didn't know this, you know, this happened, or hey, I didn't know it was, you know, to this extent. You know, word of mouth is the best that you can, to reach another person, is for another person that, you know, to tell you what they witnessed and what they've heard. And I think that's really, really important, that we know and we are aware of what's going on, because like I said, you can't deal with something if you don't know it exists. And I know in the back of our mind it exists, but most people won't take the opportunity or the time to address it until it comes to their yard. And it takes a big person to have a big heart to come out and to be a part of this today. I mean, and knowing that nothing has really happened to you personally, but for you to think outside the box and come and participate and listen to what, you know, others have to say about their life and their experiences, it's a wonderful thing. So I thank you all. And I just hope that hopefully that, you know, this is only the beginning, that we can continue to spread the word and let people know that, hey, it's not going to be tolerated. It's not, you know, we have to stand for something. You do. If you don't, I hear those saying, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. So just knowing that you all were here today and you've heard, whether you agree or disagree with any or all that you heard, I just want you to know from me to you, I appreciate you guys.
On behalf of the Ceasefire Committee, I would like to thank everyone for coming out. I appreciate ND10 for having me on the board members. I respect all the board members up here, you know, giving your insight and your input. Also, I wanted to let you guys know, we need to come together as one. When we're together, we stand as one. That's when we can control any and everything. So with that being said, if you're able to reach one, you're able to reach and teach one, definitely. And this is not my movement. I constantly tell people all the time, this is our movement. Thanks a lot for having me.
Before we go to the Q&A, Two Black is going to perform his spoken word for us, and this will also serve as his final thoughts. That's a very creative way to rock it out. Big respect.
How y'all feeling? Y'all good?
Good.
All right. been debating which poem I want to do. I've been going back and forth, and I'm doing it literally as I speak. All right, so we're going to do the one over here in my mind. All right. In a state that polices my ability to simply be decent, I pledge no allegiance in these poetry pieces. So usually my poetry ceases to show any weakness, cause I can't leave it to the evils of the American people's premature wrinkles. Therefore I'm vocally steaming to iron my creases, threading my needle, I be the poetry seamstress. Hymns are synonyms, scenes are themes pooled to meet the length in which I seek to speak. Piece by piece, ripping the stitches that stretch to a context that's properly fitted. Yet the question remains, am I big enough for my bridges? Am I just a mannequin rambling gimmicks? Talking this black shit, but when it comes to my life, am I willing to give it? I have to admit it, I am not the man that I once envisioned. You can say that I'm a handsome gremlin. On the surface of sarcasm, I'm grinning, yet inside I'm a troubled man who's trembling. Sometimes reflecting the mirror and ask, is this a man that I should hate or admire? And I'm sort of feeling a form of I'm tired, because the plight of this black life will level you with an immeasurable level of residue like trash cans, full without the liner. And it stinks to say it, yet life is a zero sum game that we're all circling around trying to decipher, because the circumference of justice is a narrow scope when you're stuck living outside of. So I spent time inside the bullseye to become the sniper. And now I got the whole world in my telescopic sight, and I place a red dot on life, don't cross me. A couple of subtle moves from you may prove too costly. Your voice of paranoid is exhausting, listening, talking. My mental space is I need to vacate to a new place, but I can't go right now because I'm wrestling with peace to bring harmony with her. And the contradiction is I'm willing to send a whole army to get her. I'm long in a gripper, but I can't reach the zone, so please pardon my temper. If the personal is political, then I'm a little bit far left of center, somewhere between a righteous and a ratchet nigga. And I've had it, nigga. Depression comes, I don't know how to combat it, nigga. I'm looking at me and myself like, yo, we about to go at it, niggas. And if that ain't messed up enough, I'm scrolling down my timeline like, yo, when they gonna hashtag you, nigga? Cause to tell you the truth, your degree and your suit ain't bulletproof. So the idea of safety is beyond me. And to take my man Theon Lee, it's like each hashtag's in a backslash. Hashtag into the backslash. Hashtag into the backslash. Tamir Rice. Hashtag into the backslash. Mike Brown. Hashtag into the backslash. Makia Boyd. Hashtag into the backslash. Nisha McBride. Hashtag into the backslash. Tamir Rice. Hashtag into the backslash. Fill in the blank. Hashtag into the backslash. Fill in my face. Hashtag into the backslash. Hashtag into the backslash. Hashtag in a backslash. And sometimes my black ass ain't stashed with words to say, and even stashed to endure the day. I try to hold and sew it together so I can patch away, hoping if I remain stoic and unopened, then these words and this black skin won't crack the cave. But I think every day a little one named part of me dies inside. Even my death is digitized. It's hard to look away when they murder me in autoplay. It's like my voice is on mute, screaming to the top of the roof. Don't shoo. I heard words of death, but sometimes it meant to be a silence. Just as violent. Thank you. Ooh.